pedagogy, the linear context interface. Yeah. So actually, this topic is different from those of the first two previous presentation. Yeah, by Dr. Dwivita, we had managing technology for learning in remote areas. And then with Professor Ndeye Bineta from America, we have PowerPoint and YouTube. Yeah, both of them sounds like a workshop, but today I would like to share something dealing with theories as well as empirical data that I collected, yeah, 3 or 4 weeks ago. Okay. This is my name, Dr. Teguh Sulistyo, MPD. Yeah, welcome to my webinar today. Yeah, I originally come from Malang. This is my beloved city, and I am teaching English at Kanjuruhan University, Malang. Okay, let me continue with the second display. Yeah, this is our agenda today. Number one is intro. And then number two, the linear context interface or LCI, and then issues on LCI. And then empirical review, yeah, that I got from 232 students from 3 different places in Indonesia. And then the implication, yeah, after discussing about LCI as well as issues, and also supported with empirical review. And the last one will be question and answer. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to share this one, screenshot. Mendikbud Nadiem Makarim minta guru dekatkan siswa dengan sains. Ya, yeah, actually this is something true. We cannot avoid it, especially in this pandemic corona. Yeah, that in cyber pedagogy, yeah, we have to be able to maximize yeah, the benefits of ICT in the world of education. Yeah, if Pak, or not Pak Nadiem, yeah, because he is very, very young. If Mas Nadiem says that guru, minta guru dekatkan siswa dengan sains, it means that we need to be able to motivate them, yeah, to maximize ICT. It can be their laptops and it can be also their mobile phone, yeah. As stated by Dr. Ginting, according to a survey, there were only 34 students in Indonesia having laptop. Yeah, so this is something irony, because now we need to conduct online learning at home, work from home, learning from home. But then, not all students have the facility in joining online learning. And then let me show you the second screenshot. 2,9 juta guru PNS dan honorer tak berkualitas bikin siswa stres ya. It was stated by Bapak Indra Karismaji. And as a result, PGRI at the time got disappointed with his statement ya. Yeah, actually that made some students getting stressed. Yeah, not only because the quality of the teacher, probably, and frankly speaking, I don't agree. I don't really agree with his statement by saying that 2.9 million guru PNS and honorer tak berkualitas. Yeah, because there are a lot of factors, yeah, affecting the mood of the students in joining online learning. And this is one of our focuses today. Yeah. So let me continue to the next screenshot. Mendikbud Nadiem Makarim akui online memang menyulitkan. Yeah. Yeah. If he says something like this, I believe that he has made a kind of study. Yeah. Because it is very important for Pak Nadiem to understand about the condition of Indonesian student, the condition of Indonesian context when we have to apply online learning, yeah. But I'm not really sure that online learning is very difficult for us, especially for you, Bapak Ibu, since I believe that you are familiar enough with ICT, you are familiar enough with online learning. Yeah, So I would like to know your perception on online learning in terms of the level of difficulty. So would you please prepare your mentimeter? Yeah, it deals with how you prepare, how you implement, and how you evaluate online learning platform. Yeah. In this context, I don't want to have a very detailed interaction in understanding your perception. You just need to write very difficult, difficult, easy, or very easy. Yeah. So would you please maximize your mentimeter, and this is the code. Yeah, I'm waiting for your response. 74, 32, and 17. Yeah. Yeah.
So they got go to menti.com. Yeah, but the go, yeah.
Yeah.
Menti.com for us to answer the question, right?
Okay. Yeah. Yeah, there are, so far there have been four audience mentioning difficult, three mentioned very easy. Four, yeah, and then five. Yeah, Bapak Ibu, can you see the result of our questionnaire? Yeah, yeah, easy and difficult. Yeah, five and five. Nobody claims very difficult. I'm happy with that. Yeah, maybe difficult in this context means in terms of we have to spend more time preparing the material, yeah. Yeah, still continues. I would like to wait for another 2 minutes, waiting for the response of the audience. But Daniel, can you see in the display upon the
yes.
response?
Yes, okay. I can
okay, thank you,
see that. Yeah, the screen is clear. But it seems that people choosing difficult scale is the most, or is the highest, yeah?
Yeah. But it is still in progress, yeah.
Still in progress, that's right, yeah. Agreement.
But nobody says very easy. Yeah. I remember the statement of my professor, yeah. It is not easy, yeah.
Yes, not easy.
I believe you remember him.
Yes, absolutely.
Okay, maybe this answer, yeah, resembles the perception of audience on how you perceive online learning in terms of the level of difficulty, preparation, implementation, and evaluation. Yeah, yeah. 10 audience, yeah, answered difficult, and then 10 answered easy. Yeah, maybe it also reflects, yeah, my own perspective that difficult in this context means we need to spare more time, yeah, in preparation and as well as in evaluation. Yeah. Okay, thank you, Bapak Ibu, for responding to my first question. Okay, let me continue to the next slide. Yeah. Yeah, Bapak Ibu, I have got your response whether online learning in terms of level difficulty dealing with preparation, implementation, and evaluation is very difficult, easy, or very easy. 10 of you answered difficult, and 8 answered easy. Yeah. Thank you very much. Yeah, I've got a picture in my mind about your perception on online learning. Yeah, So this kind of screenshot is something common happening today because now we are conducting online learning. This is an example of my student's presentation. Yeah, on student presentation. Yeah, in CCU cross culture understanding class. Yeah, how to make an intercultural relation work. Yeah, be open minded, respect each other, and practice awareness and calmness. Yeah, this is an example of synchronous platform in online learning because there will be other platform, namely asynchronous, etc. Yeah. So this is something common that we can see every day, yeah, in online learning. Yeah, I would like us to discuss a little bit about definition of the learner contact interface. Yeah, it is more or less means interaction between a student and the digital interface or the tool that mediate all interaction in the online instructional contact. Yeah, so this is the perspective of the student when they have to force, maybe in quotation mark, to force to use the tool in teaching learning process using online learning. Yeah. So it is really from the point of view of the student. So by understanding the learner contact interface, yeah, we as teachers, as lecturers, cannot force our students to follow what we want. Yeah, instead we need to understand their condition. Yeah, if we have to apply a good platform, for example, but if the students cannot join the class because of two things, maybe the level of literacy, the level of digital literacy, and number two is availability, yeah, of the support, yeah, like what I would like to show you next, yeah. And in fact, yeah, the notion of the learner context interface originate from learners' reflections and perspective on the meaning of distant language learning or online learning and its unique characteristic, yeah. So we need to understand their reflection, yeah, what they feel, what they experience, and then what they would like to say about the implementation of online learning in daily life. Yeah, it will be very different for Universitas Terbuka, for example, because the students of UT are really sure they really understand what they have to do during teaching learning process in the semester. Yeah, because in the beginning they understand that they would like to have online learning. Yeah, meanwhile in today's condition, yeah, some students are not really ready with online learning because of the pandemic of corona. Somehow when we are teaching, we need to
dosen terus juga saya share informasi sebenarnya kayak gini-gini gak ono sing ngikuti kan saya mesti ikut saya lihat ada gak orang WP yang ikut ya Mek Eris tok sing melu rajin itu. Ya apa ibu-ibu
apa-apa kan di mute.
Bapak Ibu, please turn off the audio so it won't distract the presenter. Okay, please turn off. Okay, please mute, Bapak Ibu. Okay, thank you very much for your attention. Okay, thank you.
Please. Yeah, the student of UT are really sure they really understand that they have to do online. They have to experience online learning during the whole semester. But with the student right now, non-UT, maybe some of them are ready to have to join online learning, but maybe the rest, yeah, are not ready due to their own condition. Yeah. So in this context, learner contact interface tries to understand how the students behave towards the existence or toward the implementation of online learning and its unique characteristic, yeah, because it can be done flexibly when and where. Yeah. Next, one of the major advantages of online learning is the expanded opportunities that they offer for when and where learning takes place and are observable. Yeah. Based on my experience, when I was teaching my students in writing using BAL, block-assisted language learning, yeah, there were 30 students joining the class, and by the end of the semester, by the end of the class, yeah, I asked them their perspective, their opinion about the implementation of block-assisted language learning in writing class. 25 of them, yeah, said that they were very happy, yeah, with the new platform in learning because they can. They have competition as well as collaboration directly in one platform. Meanwhile, 5 students rejected block-assisted language learning due to 2 reasons. Number one, the first reason was that lack of technology literacy, and number 2 is that lack of self-confidence in sharing their products, in this context, their assets in the blog. Yeah. So, yeah, this is the fact, yeah, actually. Yeah. Yeah. When talking about online learning, yeah, we need to take into account into 2 things. Number 1, learners technology savvy or learners technology literacy, whether they are familiar enough with technology or not. Yeah. It will really influence how they behave towards the online learning that we are conducting with them. And then number 2, availability of the ICT support. Yeah, it can be about the facilities, can be internet connection. Yeah, as we see that in Indonesian context, yeah, maybe some areas are still lack of good connection. Yeah, I can prove it later on by having communication with my student during online learning. Yeah, and also maybe as stated by Pak Daniel, only 34 students, according to a survey, only 34 students of Indonesian students have a computer or maybe laptop. So it makes them in a difficult situation when they have to join online learning. Yeah, the two things, namely learners technology savvy and availability of the ICT support, probably will have implication on this thing. Yeah, so they will have attitudes toward technology mediated learning activities, and in this context, online learning. Maybe they like online, or maybe they dislike online learning, yeah, because of their technology savvy. And then number 2, yeah, the two factors probably also will affect outcomes of language learning. Yeah, the outcome of language learning can be affected by how the learners behave towards ICT, towards online learning, and then also whether or not they have enough support in ICT. And the 2 results will affect one to another. Yeah, in the sense that if they are happy, if they can join the class very well because of the 2 support, learners technology savvy and availability of the ICT support, maybe the outcomes of language learning will be much better, will be in the maximum zone. Yeah, and also when they are happy with the outcomes, they will say that, okay, next time I would like to have online learning again with my teachers. Yeah, because it is very, very flexible for some of them. Yeah, but there is no guarantee if the students are happy with technology, are happy with online learning, that the outcomes will be always good. Yeah, so maybe we need to have a further study on it, ya. Bapak Ibu and ladies and gentlemen, let me continue. Yeah, I would like to show you an example of a screenshot with my student. Yeah, it deals with students technology savvy. Mohon maaf Bapak, apakah saya bisa ketemu jenengan sebisanya Pak Teguh? Soalnya saya bingung aplikasi Zoom-nya cara share dan cara memunculkan PPT-nya, ya. And then, yeah, I need to be patient in this context, ya. By answering, gampang saja Mas. Itu bagian bawah ada share, tinggal klik and tampilkan PPT. And actually, this is one of my students getting difficulties in Zoom, ya. Actually, he was about to have sempro, ya, seminar proposal for his skripsi, but then he got difficulties in, yeah, in understanding how to use PPT, ya. It sounds very very funny, ya, to me, but ya, kasihan juga sebenarnya, ya. So it is one of the realities of Indonesian student, ya. So they share, ya, this PPT, this screenshot deal with learner's technology savvy. It means that he still lacks of technology in using Zoom, and he got very very worried. Ya, saya bisa membaca apa begitu bingungnya. Begitu Pak, ya, bingung saya Pak. Mohon maaf ganggu panjenengan, ke? Ya, ya, saya agak ketawa, tapi saya juga kasihan. And next, ya, another problem. Assalamualaikum sir, I'm sorry. I cannot join the teleconference via Zoom because the problem of connection. Yeah, yeah. It's just that availability of the ICT support also affects the students' present in online learning. Yeah. So in this case, I would like to motivate her in this context by saying that, okay, hope this Thursday you can get in. Sorry, sir, for just now, no problem. Aini, yeah, her name was Aini. I know you tried to get in. I could see it in the display. Yes, sir, I will try my best, sir, yeah. So these are two small proofs or evidences that with the condition of lack of learner's technology savvy as well as availability of the ICT support can really affect online learning. Yeah. So in this context, I hope that all teachers, all lecturers need to understand the condition of our students. Yeah. Tapi jangan, tolong jangan terlalu kejam, harus dan harus itu ya. We need to understand this kind of condition. Yeah, besides talking about limitation of the students, yeah, I would like to have something in writing one class. Yeah, this is my screenshot. I posted an assignment on adjective clause in the Google Classroom. You have to watch the video and make 5 sentences about the video. I provided an example for you. See the due date. It is not difficult. I know you can perform your best. Yeah, look, the students responded by saying, okay, sir, and also to accompany my instruction, I posted also my voice in WhatsApp group, yeah, because I would like them to be motivated in learning, not to be isolated, yeah, even though we are so far away, I would like them to see that the teacher is always there, yeah. It's always there, giving suggestion or giving explanation or giving a help, etc. Yeah. Yeah, Bapak Ibu, I would like to continue to the next. Yeah, this one. Yeah, Dita. Yeah, this is my S2 class. I love Zoom, sir. Zoom is addicted than others. Yeah, I'm really happy with this kind of comment because the students look enjoy the class even though it was done in online, even though we were far away, but by the existence of Zoom, by the existence of Google Meet, or maybe like what we are using right now, MS Team, so we can be in one line. Yeah, it means that we can not only have two-way communication, but in the class using Zoom, we can have multi-way communication, yeah, involving student teacher communication and also vice versa, and also the communication among the students. So I would like to call it as multi-way communication. Yeah. But then I still found something like this. I'm sorry, sir, I couldn't join the class because the electricity went out starting at 3 p.m., sir. Yeah. Okay, Mbak Winda, there will be another meeting. Billion thanks, sir. Yeah. So we cannot avoid this kind of trouble. Yeah. Even though ICT is very, very modern, but it has also a lot of weaknesses. One of them is when there is no electricity, when it is blackout, yeah, it is very hard for us to conduct our class using online platform. Yeah, so these are positive responses on online learning, yeah, because of availability as well as students, ICT literacy. Next, yeah. Before implementing our online learning, yeah, we need to be careful. We need to take into account classroom diversities. Yeah, of course, in our class, something that we can observe is about genders. Yeah, female and male. Yeah, for me, there are only two, female and male, and then ability of the students in language learning. Maybe some of them have very high competence in English. Maybe some of them belong to average, and maybe in the rest belongs to very low achiever. Yeah. by understanding their different ability, we need to think of a lot of things before implementing online learning. Yeah. One of the things that I did, yeah, or I have been doing, is that providing students in PPT, not only PPT only with visual, but also I empower my PPT using my voice, yeah, and then also motivation, yeah. In fact, in my class in online learning, when I have a discussion on WhatsApp group, for example, yeah, some students are really motivated to ask questions, to provide their ideas, yeah. No matter the ideas are right or wrong, for me it is not important. The most important thing is that they have done their best. And then cultural backgrounds, yeah. In Indonesia, we have a lot of cultural backgrounds, and we need to understand this kind of condition. Yeah, let alone in my campus, Kanjuruhan University, maybe 50% of students, yeah, come from Java, and the rest come from outside Java with their different cultural background. So I need to consider this kind of facts about cultural background. And then also learning style. Yeah, in learning style, there are some subdivision presented by different experts, and one of them is about independent and dependent learners. Yeah, some students who belong to independent usually get very motivated in joining the class, online learning class, while dependent, yeah, I hope that they also will be motivated. And also another kind of style, yeah, can be whether our students belong to visual, belong to audio or kinesthetic, yeah. If we present only a PPT without voice, maybe it will work with the student of visual, but maybe it will not work in a maximum way for those belong to audiolingual, yeah. And then technology literacy, we need to understand about how our students, yeah, acquire technology literacy in their life, yeah. Yeah, and there are still many diversities actually in the class. Yeah, I conducted a small study related to this topic, and together on a small study related to online learning. Yeah, I had planted Daniel, there was another sound.
Oke, Bapak Ibu mohon cek audionya dimatikan supaya tidak mengganggu jalan presentasi. Oke, Pak Teguh.
Iya. Yeah. First, I got 232 respondents of university level dealing with their problems, dealing with their preferences, dealing with their commitment in online learning, and I got the respondents from three different demographics, from Malang City, and then from Banda Aceh, especially from Universitas Akuala. Thank you, Pak Saiful, for having helped me to get this data, and also from Palu, Universitas Tadulako. Thank you, Bu Dr. Rofiko, for having helped me to get this data. Yeah. So, Bapak Ibu, based on the responses of the respondent, I would like to show you the result. Ya, in question number 3, saya sangat sering menggunakan media-media berikut ini ketika belajar secara online. There are 232 responses. But remember, one student may provide more than one answers. I allowed them to answer in two. So 97.8%. of them use WhatsApp, because WhatsApp is very, very simple. They can respond to our teacher's comment, or maybe they can respond to their friend's comment while lying down on the bed and typing. And then also we have email, 78.9%. I also use email, but especially email is implemented for bimbingan skripsi, Bapak Ibu, And then for Edmodo, 32.8%. And then Google Classroom, it is also very popular among the students because 142 of them use Google Classroom when joining online learning. And then also this one, Zoom Cloud Meeting, 160 students, or 69.4 students, use Zoom Cloud. So it is not wonder that the owner of Zoom Cloud now is very, very rich. It is good, I think. And the rest, give only 1% or maybe less than 1% with Canvas, Telegram, Instagram, or maybe Spada, and also others, And then talking about hambatan ketika belajar secara online, we can see that most of them confessed that 80.6% or 194 students got difficulties in internet connection. It also happens to me, actually, to my student. And then peralatan laptop, 149 students, and phone and kuota internet. Maybe we need to support them with electric balance. Understanding this fact, koneksi internet, so sometimes we need to be wise in giving online learning activities. Sometimes I have to say, okay, I will delay the due date of submission, something like that. Next, penilaian saya terhadap efektivitas media menggunakan online, 43 of them say tidak efektif, 45 say efektif, and the rest say sangat efektif and sangat tidak efektif. It depends on their perspective. And then saya menilai kemampuan belajar saya dengan teknologi, almost all of them say quite enough, memadai. And next, this is something important. I would like to skip it. Apabila Anda diberi pilihan, this is something important, Anda akan memilih mode pembelajaran secara, 49 of 6 selected tatap muka or face to face, and then but I'm happy with 45.7%. Said that they would like to have combination, blended, combination between online and face-to-face, and the rest said they would like to have online learning. Yeah, maybe to some of them, it is the first time they have online learning, but maybe for the rest, it is not really something new. So they probably have different perspective. Yeah, yeah, I would like to this one. I would like to skip this one. Yeah, yeah, I would like to have about specific barrier. Yeah, it has something to do with the responses of 232 students. Number one, the lack of a way to describe learning tools. Yeah, sometimes it is not easy for us to have this one. And then difficulty in creating the design. Yeah, difficulty here to me that it is not how it is difficult, but maybe it deals with about time management, yeah, because we need to have spend more time, yeah, preparing as well as evaluating the activities, yeah, yeah. It also proves with Bapak Ibu perception on the first Mentimeter that 10 of you answered difficult, while 8 of you answered very easy. Yeah, then the tension of working with a complex specification. Yeah, some students, yeah, as well as teachers, maybe get difficulties in online learning due to complex specification of the platform. Yeah, trust and connectedness. Yeah, this is something important. We need to have trust to our student and connectedness. Yeah, trust here maybe deals with whether or not we believe that this our own students, yeah, do their own works, or maybe the work is done by other people or other friends. Yeah, we don't know exactly, but with online learning we need to have positive perception about our student. Yeah, in fact that I use Turnitin. Yeah, I use Turnitin to check my student work. If I see that there is something agak mencurigakan gitu ya, something suspicious about the work, yeah, so I apply Turnitin. Yeah, Professor Deye Bineta also suggested that we use Turnitin to check plagiarism. Yeah, and then also connectedness. Connectedness deals with our efforts to minimize the feeling of students, especially in the sense of being isolated. Yeah, because some of them maybe feel that they are alone when learning using online platform. Yeah, next. Yeah, implication for e-learning design. Wholly online learners in the early years of a course might have a low level of autonomy and require a level of structure in order to bridge the transactional distance. Yeah, maybe some of them in the beginning of the activities have low level, but autonomy especially, yeah, because in online learning we need to try hard to make our student to be autonomous, but it is very very hard indeed based on my experience. Yeah, more mature learners with higher level of autonomy may be able to manage their own learning easily with little support and may readily form online communicatives of practice. Yeah, in fact, I have got a lot of japri, yeah, from my students, text from my student asking, Pak, I still got difficulties. Yep. Yeah. When learning activities require interpersonal dialogue, this may also need to be structured by the teacher. Yeah, so we need to be the initiator to have dialogue with them. Yeah. Yeah, the last one, I would like to have one more Mentimeter with you. Will ICT replace the position of a teacher? State your opinion here in Mentimeter, code 74, 32, and 17. Yeah, I would like to see whether or not ICT will be able to replace the position of a teacher. Would you please give your response? I would like to be waiting.
please type menti.com, everyone, okay? menti.com, and you begin to share your ideas there, okay?
Yeah, disagree. ICT will replace the position of a teacher. Yeah. Some of you, six, answered disagree.
But
strongly disagree. Agree. Nobody says strongly agree. Yeah. Maybe I need to wait for one more minute. Yeah, to really understand about Bapak Ibu perception. Yeah, about the question whether or not ICT will replace the position of a teacher. Yeah. One, strongly disagree, 10, disagree, 2, agree, yeah. 2, strongly disagree. 11, disagree. 11, 12, yeah, nobody says strongly agree. Yeah, thank you, Bapak Ibu, for your perception, for your answer dealing with the question whether or not ICT will be able to replace the position of the teacher. Yeah, there are three audience answered strongly disagree, 12 answered disagree, and 2 of them answered agree. Yeah. Okay, maybe for those who say or who believe with the answer agree, yeah, maybe you are based on your experiences, it can be the existence or the presence of teacher can be replaced by ICT, especially in online learning. And then 12 audience answered agree, yeah, maybe. And also 4 answer strongly agree, because you believe that however the condition, yeah, and then whether even though technology is very very high, we believe that the presence of a teacher is still important for them. Yeah, I watched a video of an elementary school students crying, saya kangen ibu guru, kangen teman-teman, etc. Yeah, but it will never happen in university level, maybe. Yeah, okay, 5 answers strongly disagree, 13 answers disagree. Okay, Bapak Ibu, I would like us to have this one. Yeah, this is my perspective. Technology won't replace teachers. Yeah. Yeah, 18 of you also agree with me by stating strongly disagree and disagree that technology will never ever replace the presence of a teacher in the classroom. Yeah, a classroom in this context is not only limited on a room, but with online learning, classroom also exists. Yeah, in the sky, yeah, exists in our laptop, exists in our WhatsApp, email, etc. Yeah, somehow we need to believe that bad teachers who use technology will probably replace teachers who do not use technology. Yeah, it indicates that we as teachers, we as lecturers, we need to upgrade our technology literacy, yeah, unless we will be left behind. Yeah, I'm afraid that the students, yeah, will be more literacy, will have more literacy, technology literacy than the teachers. Yeah, and it actually deals with the generation. Yeah, because based on my experience, yeah, I ever heard that a professor could not maximize technology because of due to lack of technology, yeah, because it belong to different generation. Yeah, meanwhile, almost all of you belong to Y generation and I belong to X generation, but still I need to upgrade myself in understanding ICT much better. Yeah. Thank you for the responses. Yeah, five strongly disagree, 13 disagree, and 2 agree. Yeah. This is the last. Technology is just a tool in terms of getting the kids working together and motivating them. The teacher is most important. It is stated by Bill Gates, yeah, the father of ICT in the world, yeah, the father of Microsoft, yeah. Bapak Ibu, I think this is the end of my presentation. Hoping that it will be beneficial for us to share together. In case any question, I would like to discuss it with you all. Thank you very much, Pak Daniel.
Thank you. Thank you, Pak Teguh. Thank you very much for wonderful presentation. So let me and everybody give applause to Pak Teguh. Thank you very much, Pak Teguh. Wow. So, wow, that's good. So, Pak Teguh, we as teachers have to be fully aware of the things that have changed. Now we are in the era of technology. You have ended your presentation with a very good quotation. Okay, so ICT will never replace the teachers, but the teachers who know about technology and use technology for teaching will replace those who will never do that. Is that right? But yeah, that's very good. Now, Pak Teguh, we have a question and answer session, Pak Teguh. May yeah. I take over the screen for a while, Pak Teguh?
Of course. Of-
Oh, right. Okay. No, I'm not supposed to show you this later. That's exit ticket, Pak Teguh. Okay. So this is about the question, right, that we have from the Padlet. Can you see that, Pak Teguh, on the screen?
Yeah. Nothing.
Can you see? All right. Nothing. Okay. I think it takes several seconds.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I can see it.
Okay, let me read that for you, Pak Teguh. Okay, so this is one of the questions from the participants. Besides connection problems during online learning, how actively engage in the online learning? That's the first question, Pak. Would you answer that?
Okay. Thank you. It is a good question. Besides connection problem during online learning, how to attract our EFL students actively engaged in our online learning? Yeah. With any kind of condition, don't be discontent with the condition. Yeah. Since as teachers, we are the models of our students, so we need to be stay motivated in teaching. Even though it is for me, it is really hard to handle 8 classes in a week using online learning in terms of time management. I don't know whether it is Bapak or Ibu, how to attract our students actively engaged in our learning. I have tried a lot of things with regards to online learning. I have implemented a lot of platform, Zoom, but it is not always because I need to understand the student burden if I have a lot of implementation on Zoom. Yeah. Instead, when giving them material in the form of PPT, let me show you. This is one of my ways. This is Bapak Ibu. Instead of giving only a PPT without the voice of the teacher, the voice of the lecturers, I also accompany my PPT using this one. This is in CCU class, Cross Cultural Understanding, or it is also called apa ya, mata kuliah sekarang ya. Ya, sisi ya. This is one of my ways in.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Morning guys. Yeah, I hope that everybody is in a good condition, yeah. Today we are talking about folk and popular culture, in which last week we discussed about definition of culture. As I told you, that culture is one of the most complicated term to be discussed because it has a lot of variable, yeah. So hopefully that discussing this topic, you'll understand about the differences on and also the implication of folk and popular culture. Let's try to continue to the next step, to the next slide. Yeah, you see, folk culture more or less means original culture of a certain group of people, and it is not intended for a mass audience beyond that community. Yeah. So in Indonesia, we are rich of cultures.
Yeah, Bapak Ibu, this is one of my ways in bridging, communication between me and my students. Yeah, so by doing this, I would like them to be motivated by listening to my voice, because by lying down on the bed, they can learn by listening to my presentation or my clarification on the PPT. Besides, I also apply something simple in WhatsApp by providing this voice. Yeah.
In this case, I give you a video, an interesting video about culture shock in the United States. So what you have to do is watching the video, then making 5 sentences using the checking clause that we discussed last week. Yeah. The previous 2 weeks, we discussed a lot about adjective clauses using relative clause and relative pronouns, using who, whom, which, that, and zero, plus where, when, and why. So please try to practice your ability in understanding adjective clauses by making 5 sentences about the video. And you have to submit it in the Google form. In the Google Classroom, in Tugas Corner. Okay, thank you very much. Stay at home and keep learning. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Yeah, this is another way for me to get in touch with my students by involving my voice to make my students to be motivated. And also in some discussion, I always motivate my students when they make something wrong in discussion. In the form of text, I said that don't worry about making errors, yeah, because for me, making errors is only a small evidence that teaching and learning is taking place. So yeah, this is one of my ways in making my students to keep in touch with me in online learning. Maybe this is my answer. Thank you for your question.
Very good, Pak.
Daniel?
Thank you. That's wonderful. Would you stop sharing, Pak? So
Okay.
So you are very creative, Pak. You never give up. You tried any ways to make your students motivated and to keep them engaged, right? So you have tried a lot of teaching medias, and you never give up. Yes. So you always want your students to learn. So making use of some available resources, we can use this high tech or even low tech technology, but the goal is to make them learn. That's right. Okay, now I'm back to my my screen, Pa. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Can you see my screen, Pa? Can you see that? Okay. It takes several minutes, Pa. Can you see that, Pak?
Okay, yeah, I can see it.
Hey, this is very interesting because you've mentioned something about teacher's factor, right? Okay. Yeah. The interaction via social media has driven to the situation in which nobody is authoritative. Do you think teachers today still hold such authoritativeness in the perspective of their students?
Yeah.
What do you think, Pak?
Yeah, I think we should leave this kind of paradigm that a good teaching learning process exists not because of the ability of the teacher to explain the material. Teaching learning process will be considered very good, very excellent if the students are really engaged in the teaching learning process. Just let them do the activities, yeah? Meanwhile, the teachers should be able to monitor, to facilitate, or maybe to be a tutor and in different kind, in other kinds of roles, yeah? Maybe there are eight up to nine different roles of teachers, not only as a manager, not only as a controller. Sometimes a teacher must be a participant, yeah, because they would like to have more and more interaction with the student, yeah. And I think today we need to have something new in our mind that let our students creative is very good, yeah. So actually in online learning as well as in blended or maybe face-to-face learning, we need to develop what is meant by collaboration, yeah, collaborative, yeah, besides competitive among the student, yeah. So in this context, teachers, lecturers need to understand, as I said before in my slide about classroom diversities. As soon as we really understand about our student condition, it will be easier for us to have activities in the classroom. Yeah, as I told you that I cannot be strict in the classroom. For example, okay, today I'm presenting a PPT with my voice and then do the exercise and then you have to submit it tomorrow at 9, for example. Yeah. With online learning activities, probably there will be some variable that really affect the implementation of online learning, yeah, in the classroom, yeah. So nobody is authoritative. I do agree with you, yeah, because now let's try to make our students, yeah, to be free, yeah, to be free in teaching learning process, but they must be responsible with the policies, with the rules in the classroom, etc. Yeah, Pak Mas Nadiem also declares Merdeka Belajar, yeah. So dalam Merdeka Belajar tidak ada siswa yang under pressure, yeah. Just let's try to imagine if there is someone being under pressure in the classroom, I don't think that he or she will get the outcomes of learning. They will say that, wow, the class is too long, yeah, I need to go home very soon. But for those with autonomous learners, maybe they can enjoy teaching learning process by saying that, wah, kok cepat sekali ya pembelajaran. Ada semacam itu ya. So now let's try to keep in mind that students must be active in the classroom. This is one of the indicators of a good teaching learning process, not how excellent the teacher explains the material. This is my answer, Pak Ginting.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much, Pak Teguh. Okay, I think many of us are expecting to talk to you, Pak Teguh. So they would like to ask questions to you directly. Would that be possible, Pak Teguh? Okay. So I'd like to invite two questions. So, Ibu Bapak, if you would like to ask questions to Pak Teguh, please. I give two people to ask questions. Turn on your audio and please. You are welcome to ask question to Dr. Teguh. Before I'm going to move on to another question on the Padlet. Okay, everyone, you are invited to ask question to Pak Teguh.
I think there is one more question, Pak.
Yeah, there are some questions. All right. Would you like to?
More, yeah. A lot of questions, actually. Yeah.
All right. Here. Okay, while we are waiting for others to ask questions to you, Pak, here is the question. In relation to the safety problem, can you see that, Pak?
Let me make it bigger. Yeah, I can read it.
In relation to the safety problem, do you think we need separate course in technology in our ELT curriculum?
Yeah, it is very, very complicated, yeah, to answer this kind of question, yeah, because curriculum should be taken into a lot of consideration before deciding the curriculum, yeah, and one of them is technology, yeah. I think, do you think that we need separate course? Yeah. I think we need to empower our students with technology classes or courses, yeah, especially for maybe for SD, SMP, or SMA, or even perguruan tinggi. But before implementing the curriculum, yeah, we need to be sure that the man behind the curriculum, in this context, teachers and lecturers, yeah, must upgrade their own ability first, dealing with technology literacy. Yeah, it will be very, very funny if our students, have better technology savvy than us. Yeah, it will be very, very funny. Yeah, so I do agree with separated courses in technology in our ELT curriculum. I do agree with that. Yeah. Because by empowering our student with ELT, we can at least minimize the problem that our students will face when they have to join, especially online class. Yeah, not only on online class, maybe in face-to-face, because sometimes we need, even though in face-to-face, we need to ask our students to apply something, a technology, for example. Yeah, so I do agree with this one. Maybe if Pak Mas Nadim listen to our discussion, he will think of it about the need to include some courses in technology in ELT curriculum. Yeah, thank you. Yeah,
okay, so maybe next time we can invite Pak Nadim, ya Pak, ya.
I hope so, yeah, because Machung is very, very outstanding.
All right. So anyone, you are invited, please. You are invited to ask question to Dr. Teguh Sulistyo. Please unmute your audio before we are going to ask, discuss next question. One more question. Okay, everyone, please turn on your audio. So Pak Teguh, nowadays, the students are very savvy at the technology. Even the teachers have to learn. Students can learn technology a lot faster than teachers. Do you agree with that, Pak Teguh?
Yeah, it deals with the generation that they have. Yeah. Now, our students belong to Y generation or later generation, but maybe the teachers, yeah, or the lecturers, some of them belong to X generation or even baby boomer generation. Yeah. Let me tell you something about my experience. Yeah. When I was trying to give suggestion to an elementary school student in Malang near my house, yeah, because at the time the headmaster, yeah, invited me to say that, please Pak Teguh, tolong Bapak Ibu saya dikasih pembekalan sedikit lah tentang PPT dan sebagainya, ya, ya. For those who belong to, but it is not overgeneralization. Again, I would like to confess it is not about overgeneralization. Yeah. In fact, at that time, some of the teachers said to me, yeah, walah Pak Teguh, buka laptop aja nggak pernah bisa, nggak pernah ya. Terus gimana mau belajar PPT? But for those who belong to X generation, could follow ya my workshop, ya small workshop actually ya, by making PPT only actually at that time ya. How to have animation, design, etc. Ya, itulah kenyataannya Bapak ya. It deals also with the capacity of the teachers. But I believe that even though some lecturers belong to baby boomer generation in my university, Kanjuruhan Malang, yeah, I confess that all of them, even though they belong to baby boomer generation, all of them can can implement online learning. Yeah, in this semester due to the pandemic, COVID. Yeah, I believe in that, Pak Ginting. Yeah, it's not clear when we were born. Yeah.
Okay, Pak. Thank you. Okay, everyone. Do you have any questions? Okay, Pak. This yes. is. Okay, please. Sure.
Question.
Yeah. All right. Please introduce yourself, Ibu.
Sure. Well, hello, Bapak Ibu. I am Eva. From Universitas Brawijaya. Hello, Pak Teguh.
Hello,
very fruitful information. Well, based on the research that you've done there, I could see the information that your students actually mentioned that online activities, the whole part of online activity is not actually too effective to accomplish what is so-called as our learning goal. So the question is, well, actually that also happens in my university. The question is, so how can we solve this problem? So how can we utilize technology more effectively? So using what type of technology, what activity? So is there any suggestion on that, Helpa? Thank you. Thank you, Pak Ginting.
Thank you, Bu Eva Emaliana from Trabeja University. Yeah, it's a good question, but it is not easy for me to answer the question. Yeah, let me flashback to my previous display. Yeah.
Do you want to share your screen?
Oh yeah. Okay.
Do you want to share? Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. I'm preparing my display, yeah. Yeah. Just a minute.
Took your time, but it's fine.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, it works.
Yeah.
Wonderful.
Yeah,
you can see that. Go ahead.
Yeah, Bu Eva and Bapak Ibu, all of you. Yeah, I would like to refresh our mind related to this fact that learners technology savvy and availability of the ICT support, affect the students' perception about online. Yeah, saya punya mahasiswa yang pintar, Ibu Eva ya, dan Bapak Ibu ya, tapi karena koneksi internetnya dia tinggal di desa terpencil, since he lives in a remote area, in which it is very hard for her to have an internet connection, even in her own presentation in a group, in pairs at the time, she failed to join, because of the condition, because of the bad condition, namely the lack of internet connection. So she said to me, sorry, sir, I cannot present my material due to bad connection. I would like to send my PPT that proving that I'm actually ready to do this, but in fact it is not supported by good internet connection. Yeah, so with the unavailability of the ICT support, it will really affect student perception. So that's why they say that Iya, kalau gitu online learning tidak efektif, ya. Karena saya merasa pintar tapi tidak bisa presentasi semacam itu ya. Even though I said to her, okay, try again next time, ya. In this context, we as teachers and as lecturers, we need to understand our students' condition, ya. So that's why when someone says that online learning is not effective, probably they have this kind of problem, learner technology savvy and availability of the ICT support, or probably there will be another variable, yeah, because the student really loves the lecturer, for example, yeah, because the lecturer is very beautiful. It can be, yeah. Sorry, I'm just making a joke, yeah. And with these two kind of condition, the two condition affect student attitude toward technology mediated learning activities in this context online learning. So, yeah. In this context, yeah, we still have some discrepancies, yeah, to maximize online learning. It will be different for students of UT, Universitas Terbuka, because in the beginning they really understand that they have to do online learning. It is different from our universities, for example, yeah, without any announcement in the beginning. When pandemic of this COVID, yeah, appeared, and then yeah, I still remember it began in meeting number 6. Then I started to have online learning. Yeah, in the previous, in the meeting one up to 5, I conducted face-to-face activities. Yeah, so Bu Eva, probably the two factors, learner technology savvy and availability of the ICT support, will really affect students' opinion about online learning, yeah. But don't worry, Bapak Ibu, with the spread of technology, with the existence of Corona COVID, yeah, I think from now on, Corona COVID has also taught us how to prepare our students, how to empower our students, how to empower teachers and lecturers with technology. So I think, yeah, Corona also has very, very positive effects on education, yeah. Jadi kita tidak boleh mengeluh, tapi dengan adanya Corona ini, bagaimana pembelajaran tetap bisa berjalan. We need to have positive thinking about Corona, yeah. Don't blame it on Corona every time, yeah. Corona also gives us a lot of thought, yeah, a lot of perception, a lot of facts that from now on, yeah. And I still remember the first question given by someone, about it is very important for us to provide courses on in technology, yeah. I do agree, yeah. Maybe we can think of it about the importance of providing courses on ICT or maybe on online learning classes, yeah. Okay, this is my answer. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, hoping Bu Eva, it will really answer your question. Thank you very much for the excellent question.
Okay, so there are some factors to consider, to put into our considerations, yeah, Patiko, yeah?
Yeah.
So we have to look at the students, how they are ready with the technology. So sometimes students have different level of digital literacy as well, right?
Yeah.
Not to mention some technological supports. You mentioned that our students are living in the areas where the internet connection would be very impossible to get. And particularly one day I attended the webinar, the students in Kalimantan, they had to walk some kilos to find the hill in order to get the signal, but only to get the signal. All right.
Can you mention the city?
Singkawang or something like that.
Singkawang, yeah. I know the condition, yeah.
Yes.
A little bit.
little bit about that. Yeah. Okay, so the students factor, technological support, and also teaching delivery skills, especially related to technology and also the materials. We have some available materials using high-tech or low-tech audio, visual, movies, something like that. And also the support from the environment and from the government, from the family. But this is very important as well. All right. So, next question, please. Okay, next person.
Pak Daniel, I would like to ask questions.
Okay, sure. Introduce yourself.
Yes, my name is Lulu. I'm from UPI. Hello, Pak Teguh.
Hello, Ibu Lulu.
I'm from Bandung, Pak Daniel. My question actually more to asking for your experience, Pak Teguh. In your experience, when you are having an online class, when giving assessment, what are there any effective ways in giving assessment in an online class, especially if the online class is not always synchronous? Sometimes most of the times actually my online class is asynchronous. So in your experience, maybe if it is a synchronous or asynchronous online class, what are the more effective assessment for the students?
When talking about which one is more effective, we need to conduct a further study on it. But based on my experience, whatever the condition, as I said before, teaching learning process must go on. Usually, if I give my students assignments, I ask them to submit it, to post it in Google Classroom, in Tugas Kelas. So in this platform, I have a corner to give my comment, as well as I can send the score for each student. And the score can be seen only by the students themselves. By doing this, I also connect my email to my Google Classroom. So every time my students give comment, I could easily give my comment back. For example, thank you, Pak. Thank you, sir. I have got your feedback. I would like to learn more based on feedback. By using this, that I would like to motivate my student that, because according to an article that I read in an online news, that guru hanya memberi tugas tanpa memberikan materi maupun evaluasi. It is very wrong if we give them only material and then assignment without giving them feedback. To me, giving them feedback is something nice, even though I have to spend more time, watching my laptop, As a result, today I'm wearing my glasses, due to, the effect of being in front of laptop, It can be 8 to 10 hours in a day, So by giving feedback via Google Form, Google Classroom, as well as the score. Usually my student said, thank you, sir, for giving me the feedback. I need to learn more based on your feedback. And also, thanks, sir, to me that the score is too high for me. What do you think? For me that if I give them too low score, it is fair to my understanding that I would like to give appreciation to my student to work hard, But in giving feedback, Bu Lulu and Bapak Ibu, I combine my activities both synchronous and asynchronous. Yeah, using synchronous, usually when I would like to give overall feedback, yeah. For example, in my micro teaching class, yeah, with this kind of condition, it is very impossible to ask my students to have teaching practicum in the classroom. Yeah, instead, yeah, because some of them are in their hometown. Yeah, so I asked them to make a video of teaching performance by inviting some neighbors, maybe, or some friends of their age. Yeah, and they act as if they are in front of real students. Yeah, so they send me the video of their teaching performance. Then I watch the video one by one. Yeah, while watching, I also type my feedback in the Google Classroom. Yeah, and this is for individual assessment, individual evaluation. But for overall, I apply Zoom, or apply Google Meet, to give my overall feedback. Yeah, and by using Zoom or maybe teleconference like this, there will be multi-way communication, not only between students and the lecturer, but also among the students. Yeah. So when I give a comment, for example, guys, before teaching, make sure that in pre-teaching activities, make sure that you have to activate your student background knowledge related to the topic that you are going to discuss, for example, yeah. And by doing so, I can ask one student or two students to say, what do you think about pre-teaching activities? So, using synchronous platform, then we can have real-time communication. And it will be easier for us to have multi-way communication. Yeah. So two ways that I have been applying, synchronous and asynchronous. Yeah. Thank you, Bu Lulu.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Pak.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Okay. Thank you very much. Bapak Ibu, tolong audionya dimatikan dulu supaya lebih konsentrasi untuk diskusi. Sekali lagi, audionya Bapak Ibu dimatikan. Nah, terima kasih.
Okay.
Right. Okay, Pak Teguh, I think we have one more question, and this is a good question, Pak Teguh, from the participants. Can you read it on your screens, Pak?
Yeah, I'm reading it.
Let me make it bigger. Online learning trains students to be more autonomous learners, and they are also given opportunity to apply their metacognitive awareness. In my experiences, when I ask my students whether they understand the materials, most of the students say yes. But then, when I validated with their work, they still found problems, actually. In your experiences, how do you help your students to be more honest with their ability in learning, or in another word, to develop their metacognitive awareness in online learning?
Okay.
What would you like to say, Pak?
Yeah, it is a very nice question. Yeah, metacognition. Yeah, metacognition means thinking about thinking. Yeah. So the students with or autonomous learners, usually they can apply metacognitive awareness in a maximum way, in the sense that they need to think of their plan. They need to think of their own, after joining a class, whether or not I have understood the material or not, Also, based on my performance, what I have to do, I should have to do next, It is the ability of metacognition, Usually, autonomous learners, are those who apply metacognitive awareness, and usually they are also independent, I have some in my classroom, in my my classroom, and when asking a question, yeah, it is not only in online learning, yeah, in face to face, yeah, before ending the class, after summarizing the material, usually I ask a question. Any question? Yeah, before they answer the question, I say no, yeah, because I know that you are ready to go home, yeah, yeah. Somehow I have also a classroom in which that when I said that sorry, time is very limited, we still have one more time, but still some of them ask question. Yeah, usually the students who are very curious to understand more about the material, yeah, usually get higher achievement, yeah, than those who are reluctant or maybe who are maybe not too reluctant, yeah, maybe they are shy, something like that, yeah. With the shy students, we need to have social strategies, yeah, by having good communication. For example, when they are doing their assignment, yeah, or their task in the classroom, we can go to each students asking any question, any problem, yeah, because we need to check whether or not our student are still on the track of the task, or maybe they still get difficulties, or maybe they need help. Yeah, usually some students are very shy to ask, yeah, to ask question. Yeah, yeah, due to about maybe due to the personalities of the student. Yeah, but when I evaluated it with their work, they still found problem. Actually, in your experiences, do you help your students to be more honest with their ability? Yeah. Okay, I have usually I open also question and answer, yeah, in asynchronous way by asking question to my students in WhatsApp, yeah, because for me it is the easiest way for the student to give comment. For example, it happened yesterday, I asked a question after providing PPT as well as asking the student to do the assignment. I ask question, any question? Yeah, I did it at 12 o'clock, and then I say, please answer, please have question. Then some students ask question by asking, for example, like this. Since we are talking about adjective clause, by dropping some words over there. Yeah, for example, this one, yeah. As I comment like this, as I told you in PPT plus, yeah, PPT plus meaning PPT with my voice, no matter the original verb, you have present blah, 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 it must be changed into verb ing, yeah. At the time, I asked my students to change, to drop some word, yeah. Let me give you an example. The man who came to your house yesterday left for New York this morning, yeah. I asked my students to drop who, yeah, so they have to change into the man coming to your house, yeah. So the question of my student is that, yeah, but it is only active voice, or yeah, something like that, yeah. That's why it is active voice. We change the verb, any kind of verb, into verb ing, yeah. For example, the man coming to your house yesterday. Kemudian ada yang bertanya lagi, Pak, itu kan sudah kemarin, kenapa harus change yang bukan change? Ya, my answer is that because you drop who, ya. When you have, yeah, when you drop who, or maybe that, or maybe which, then you have to change the verb directly into ing. No matter the form of the tenses. Yeah, this is. And of course, metacognitive awareness is not something simple, ya, Bapak Ibu. Yeah, I also get difficulties to motivate my students. Yeah, so in my micro teaching class, yeah, in order to activate my students' metacognitive awareness, I ask my students for final exam by asking, okay, guys, what you have to do for your final exam is that, number one, you have to watch the video of your teaching performance once again, or maybe more and more. And then number two, you have to think of your own performance by trying hard to find your weaknesses during the teaching performance. and then strengths, and then you have to think of also besides thinking or finding out your strengths and weaknesses, you have to think of something important, namely in what areas that you have to cover, in what areas that you have to improve, yeah, in your teaching performance. By having self-reflection like this, it is one of the ways in cultivating our students' metacognitive awareness, yeah, Pak Ibu, yeah. Because without having self-evaluation, metacognitive awareness is nothing, yeah. Because the students cannot understand their own, yeah, without self-evaluation. This is my answer. Thank you. Hoping
thank
that
you,
it thank will you. Answer your question.
Bye-bye. Yes, thank you. That's wonderful. Thank you very much. So, ladies and gentlemen, that is the end of Pak Teguh's presentation. Let us give applause to this wonderful presentation. That's good. Thank you very much, Pak Teguh, for today's presentation. Thanks a lot. Okay, so let me handle the screens again, Pak Teguh. I would like to show them what is going to happen tomorrow, right? So, Bapak Ibu, tomorrow we're gonna have a presentation by Dr. Rosswood. He is from Worldwide University, USA. Okay, please join us. Don't miss it. We're gonna have it and we start that at 10 o'clock tomorrow. All right, so right after Dr. Ross, the next day we have Professor Debra Lee from University of Vanderbilt, USA. All right, so we keep you updated. Yeah, and I think everybody is now is expecting the exit ticket. Is that right, Patago? So everyone is expecting that. I'm going to show you guys the exit ticket and I will let you to fill in the information in the exit ticket. All right. Pak Teguh, can you see that? The exit ticket.
Yep.
Okay, so everyone, this is the exit ticket for you. The committee has prepared this. Okay, please do that. We are waiting. We are waiting for you to fill in the exit ticket. So, Pak Teguh, while we are waiting for others to fill in the information in the exit ticket, would you like to tell us what is going on in your neighborhood right now? Is it quiet, Pak, in there? In your neighborhood, are people still walking, going outside, buying something? Your neighbors, Pak?
Yeah, not all, yeah. Some of them, or almost all of them, work from home. Yeah, and also my son, yeah, who is a student of Trawijaya University, is also busy with his assignment, yeah, in IT, yeah. Okay, and I hope that whatever the condition, I hope that the presence of COVID will make us more mature, yeah, in the sense that we need to understand our position right now. As a teacher, as a lecturer, we need to upgrade our ability in ICT. Yeah, not only ICT, but we need also to learn about how to get in touch with our students. Yeah, because almost all of them probably still get difficulties in joining our class. Yeah, it is a kind of problem. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you very much, Pak. So we do hope that it's going to be over.
Yeah, maybe for last time I would like to say something, Pak Danin.
Sure.
Yeah. Yeah, I would like to give. I have to say thank you very much to Fakultas Bahasa dan Sastra Chung University for having given me a chance to share my experience, even though my experience is very limited. Yeah, because I know that one of the audience is an expert actually in ICT. I know him, yeah. He is joining this is joining this.
Oh, really, Pak?
Yeah. I know him. Yeah. I know him. No. It is a secret. Yeah. It is a secret. Yeah. And okay. With all my limitation, this is the best thing that I can do for all of you, Bapak Ibu. So, once again, I'm really happy today for having shared my experience with you all, hoping that it will be beneficial for all of us. Yeah, especially for me, because when seeing the recording of my presentation, I can learn a lot of mistakes that I have done. I believe in that. Yeah, thank you very much. See you again someday again. Sure, Daniel, Emmy, yes. And Machung, thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for your wonderful presentations today. All right. Stay healthy. Waalaikumsalam. So everyone, thank you very much for your participation. And we're going to see you all online tomorrow. Okay? So let's give applause to Pak Teguh. Okay. Thank you very much. And see you tomorrow, guys. Thank you.
Thank you, Pak Daniel. Thank you, Pak Teguh.
Yes. Let me take over the screen and give them the music, please.
Thank you. Daftar jadi
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.